In this video, we're going to talk about equations in their simplest form, one-step equations. So equations that can be solved by just doing one thing. We're eventually going to get into equations that look like this, but I'm starting with simpler ones, so just bear with me if these look too easy, all right? When you were first introduced to equations, they probably looked something like this. An empty box plus 5 equals 8. And your job was to figure out what goes in that box that would make this true. Because an equation, so a sentence that has an equal sign, is a statement of equality. It means that the left side and the right side are equal, right? So you're trying to figure out what can I plug into here that would make this true. And then you may have seen the box replaced with a question mark. And now it says question mark plus 5 equals 8. Same concept, you're trying to figure out what replaces that question mark that would make this true, right? And then as you move into middle school, what you may have seen or about to see is a variable introduced, a letter that's taking the place of a number. And now most students, this is where you guys start to freak out in math once letters are introduced. And I'm here to tell you to please not worry, to please trust me. The variables are not going to make it any more difficult. All they are is just more sophisticated language. So instead of using a question mark or a box, we're now using a variable to represent the unknown. So the variable, the letter, represents some number, and we're trying to figure out what that number is. The same way that we were trying to figure it out with the question mark and the box. So don't be scared by the introduction of letters into math. It really is the same thing as that question mark and box. We're just trying to figure out what number could replace X that when I add that number to 5, I get 8, okay? So hold that thought. You've also probably seen equations like this orange one. 5 times empty box equals 20. And you're trying to figure out what goes in this box. What times 5 equals 20, right? And now again, as you move into middle school and the language gets a little more sophisticated, you're not gonna see empty boxes or question marks anymore. You're gonna see variables. So this problem would now be written like this. 5x equals 20. That X is not to be confused with this one, which is a multiplication sign. This X is a variable. Again, a variable is a letter that's taking the place of a number. It's just asking me, please find out what number I can put here that would make this true. Okay. Now, there's no multiplication sign here. You guys also may be used to seeing the dot for multiplication, right? Which is fine. There are still valid signs. But as you get older and further into your math career, you're more than likely going to see multiplication problems written like this. So when you see a number next to a variable with nothing in between, there is no addition sign, there's no subtraction sign, it means multiplication, okay? And this number has a special name and it's called the coefficient. So a coefficient is the number that's next to the variable and it's being multiplied by the variable. And the way you know it's being multiplied is because there's nothing there, okay? So again, this problem is really the same as this one, just a little more sophisticated looking, but it's saying the same thing. Find out what X is. So now, you may be saying to me, Ms. Kero, what are you even going to teach me right now? Because I could figure this out on my own, right? With a couple of seconds of thought, I'm sure that you guys could figure out that 3 is the number that would replace this X because 3 plus 5 equals 8, and that would make it true, right? Same thing here, you probably could figure out that X has to be 4 because 4 times 5 would be 20. However, answers or solutions are not always going to be as pretty as 3 and 4. And equations are not always going to be this simple. They're going to get more complicated. So as math gets more complicated, strategies are really important in order for us to solve equations and they get more complex, okay? So that's what I'm gonna introduce to you today. And there's 2 steps really that we're gonna talk about and focus on, and they're right here written in blue. Number one is that we're gonna use inverse operations to isolate the variable. So there's a lot of vocabulary in there, so I'm gonna help you break it down, okay? Inverse operations. When I talk about operations, I'm talking about your 4 simple math operations: adding, subtracting, multiplying, and dividing. Now, when we say inverse, inverse just means opposite, okay? So the inverse operation of adding would be subtracting, and the inverse operation of subtracting would be adding. The inverse of multiplying would be dividing, and vice versa, okay? So this just means opposite. We're gonna use these opposite operations to isolate. Isolate just means by itself, right? When something's in isolation, it's by itself. So we're gonna isolate, we're gonna get by itself the variable, which you now know is that letter that's taking the place of some number. So that's our goal. Our goal is let's get the variable by itself, and the way we're gonna do it is by using opposite operations. This will make a lot more sense in 2 minutes, okay? The second piece that you need to know, and maybe you wanna write down, is Whatever you do to one side of the equation, you must do to the other. This is a really, really important rule for the rest of your math career as you solve equations, okay? So like we were saying before, an equation, a statement with an equal sign tells me that two things are equal. So if I say to you that there's $5 in my left hand and $5 in my hands have equal amounts of money, right? However, if I add a dollar to one of my hands, so if I now have six here, you see that these are no longer equal. One has six and one has five. So how do I make it equal? I do the same thing to the other side. I add one here too. And now they both have six. So hopefully that concept makes sense to you. Whatever you do to one side, you have to do to the other. Otherwise, the sides wouldn't be equal. And that's the definition of an equation. We're trying to make sure that they're equal, right? So these are our two main important points that we're going to use as we solve today. So even though we already know the answers are 3 and 4, I'm going to show you how to use these strategies to get 3 and 4. So when they get more complex, you understand the strategies. So I said use inverse operation. So let's look at the x. The x is on the left side of the equal sign, and we have to figure out what's happening to it right now. Right now, the x is being added by 5. So the inverse operation of adding is subtracting. So what we're going to do is subtract 5. I'm going to write minus 5 right underneath that plus 5. But now remember the second blue point that I had for you was whatever you do to one side, you do to the other. And when I say other side, I mean other side of the equal sign. So here's the equal sign. We did minus 5 on the left side of it. Now we're going to do minus 5 on the right side of it. So we're also going to do it to the 8 to keep that balance of that equation, okay? And I'm going to show you why we did this. Because now my x value will come down, but 5 minus 5 is 0. So it does what we call canceling out. The reason it cancels out is because if this is just 0, if I add x plus 0, I'm just going to get x. So I don't need to write it, right? X plus 0, whatever x is, it doesn't matter. Anything plus 0 is that thing. So on the left side, all I have is x, which was my goal. Remember, we said we wanted to isolate. We want to get x by itself. Equal sign comes down. 8 minus 5 is 3. And there is my solution. Once I have x by itself, then I have the solution on the right side. And that's what we had anyway, right? But now you're just realizing a strategy that you can use to get that. So x equals 3. We're going to get to the check in a second. On this side, remember what I told you, a number, now you know it's called a coefficient, before a variable with nothing in between means that it's multiplication. So what's the opposite? What's the inverse operation of multiplication? It's division. So again, another sign that's going to get a little more sophisticated. We're not going to use the division symbol that you're used to. We're going to use a fraction bar to indicate division. So we're going to divide, again, both sides by 5. Why are we doing this? Because 5 divided by 5 is 1. But 1 times x, 1 times anything, is just that thing, right? 1 times 10 is 10. 1 times 15 is 15. 1 times x is just x. And again, that's my goal. Get it by itself. So now x is by itself. Equals 20 divided by 5 is 4. And again, there's that answer that we got before in our heads, but now you have a strategy, okay? Checking is going to get very important as the equations get more complex. So when you check your solution, what you're going to do is start by writing the original equation. So let's start with x plus 5 equals 8. And now if we believe that x equals 3 is our solution, what we're saying here is that x and 3 are the same thing. They're interchangeable. 3 is what x's value is, right? That means that wherever I see an x, I can write 3 instead of writing x because they're equal. They're the same thing. So instead of writing x, I'm writing 3. Everything else is going to come down. Plus 5 equals 8. And now I'm just going to evaluate. I'm going to simplify. So on the left side, I have the problem 3 plus 5. 3 plus 5 is 8. So I get 8 equals 8. And what I'm looking for here in my check is to make sure that the last statement I end up with is true. 8 equals 8 is a true statement. Replacing x with 3 made me have a true statement, which tells me that my solution of x equals 3 is correct. And the same thing will happen here. So if I take this x and I replace it with 4, so now what you don't want to do is don't write 54. When you replace it with parentheses, okay? The only reason I didn't use parentheses here is because there's a symbol in between, so it's unnecessary. But I could have also done it here. So I have 5 times 4 equals 20. And now you just multiply. 5 times 4 is 20. And we get another true statement showing us that 4 must be the correct number, because when we substituted in 4, we plugged in 4, we got a statement that was true. All right, so this is the general process, and now we're going to move on to some more complex equations. So now please don't let the decimals and fractions scare you. They're still just numbers, right? And there's still just one operation happening here. You just have to figure out what it is. So in this example, I have 4.5x equals 28.125. What is happening between the 4.5 and the x? Well, there's no math symbol here. There's no math operation. So hopefully you remember from before, that means that it's multiplication. And remember, the method that we're using is inverse operation. So we're going to do the inverse of multiplying. What's the inverse of multiplying? Dividing. So we're going to divide by 4.5. But remember, whatever we do to one side, we're doing to the other. So we're also going to divide here by 4.5, okay? Now, 4.5 divided by 4.5, anything divided by itself, 2 divided by 2, 5 divided by 5, a million divided by a million, it's always going to be 1. So 4.5 divided by 4.5 is 1. But 1 times that x is just x equals, and now we do the same thing on the right side. So 28.125 divided by 4.5. Now, if you need help dividing with decimals, I'm not going to do it in this video. You can look it up, but if you are at a grade where you're allowed to use a calculator, you can also just do that for now, and we'll get 6.25. So our solution, our answer for this problem is x equals 6.25. I should have said this before, but if you feel like you want to try these problems, please feel free to pause the video and then play and see if you got them right. Green one down here, what's happening to the x? It's being subtracted by 7. So we're going to do the inverse of subtraction, which is addition. So we're going to do plus 7 on the left, and then whatever I do to one side, I have to do to the other side, so I'm going to do it on the right side as well. My x comes down, negative 7 plus 7 cancels out. That's the whole purpose of inverse operations, is to cancel out. But I do want to make sure you understand why they cancel out. Negative 7 plus 7 is 0. Negative 7 means you owe $7. Positive 7 means you have $7. So if you owe someone $7 and you pay them with the 7 you have, you now have no money left. That's 0, right? But if I do x plus 0, I'm just going to get x. So I don't need to write the plus 0. It cancels out. Equals. Now on the right side, negative 12 plus 7. Again, I'm not going to go too much into depth with adding and subtracting integers. If you need help with that, you might want to watch another video, but I'll try to quickly explain it. I always explain it using money. So negative 12 means I owe somebody $12. Positive 7 means I have $7. So imagine taking those $7 and paying that person that you owe. You're still going to owe money. So my answer is a negative answer, right? Because I haven't paid them in full. How much money do you still owe? $5. So my answer here is x equals negative 5. Again, if you're at a grade level where you're allowed to use a calculator, go for it. But I do encourage you to watch another video so you can be more familiar about how to operate with integers without a calculator. All right, so x is negative 5 here. And then the last problem, 2/3 x equals 16. So 2/3, even though it's a fraction, don't let it scare you. It's still just a number that's being multiplied by x. So we still can just do the opposite of it. So if we're multiplying x by 2/3, let's divide by 2/3. And I know this is going to look really weird, but it's, again, a number divided by itself. So what's it going to be? 1. It doesn't matter that it's a fraction. Anything divided by itself is 1. So this is going to cancel and be 1. 1 times x is just x, okay? And on the right side, again, I don't want to go too much into detail, but if you have trouble multiplying and dividing fractions, you should watch another video on it to get familiar. Or again, if you are able to use a calculator, go for it. But we're doing 16 divided by 2/3. So now I'm going to quickly explain. When you divide with fractions, 16 divided by 2/3, you're multiplying by what we call the reciprocal. The reciprocal means you flip the fraction around, okay? And then when you multiply by the reciprocal, there's a bunch of ways I could explain this to you. My shortcut is going to be to say 2 goes into 16 8 times, and 8 times 3 is 24. So x equals 24 here. I know I did this really quickly. If you need help with dividing fractions, please watch another video. I just want to make sure I get through the equation process, okay? Okay, I'm leaving you with these four practice equations, and as always, the answers are going to be in the description part of the video. And if you're not getting the correct answers, but you're not sure why, please feel free to reach out for help. Good luck.